Give me your keys. We're going somewhere.
Who's going?
We're going. Us. The Groovers, now.
You ever have any regrets?
About what?
Certain women.
I've never been serious about a woman in my life, son. You know that.
Before Vietnam, a last binge. Fandango at 7:30 tomorrow on BBC1.
Gypsies are the Europeans under scrutiny on BBC2 in a minute when Chantal Couer reports on the different treatment these itinerants receive across Europe, retaining their traditions and cultures during centuries of wandering. Gazing into BBC1's crystal ball in half an hour, Alf sees red when Gwyneth disrupts his peace by holding a seance. That's after we've discovered there's nowt as strange as folk.
It's people, your stories, ordinary people doing amazing things. Here's what we've got for you tonight. Whatever happened to the problem kids we filmed in 1973? Chris Sell beats the bounds with the vicar and his choir and ends up losing his way. But first, more of Tom's fantastic story. He spent a lifetime looking for his real family and then made an amazing discovery. He was working right next to his real brother Steve.
As I was cutting the blonde away, I could see this dark hair underneath. And I said, God, you've got dark hair, Steve, because he's quite pale in his complexion. I said, you got any foreign blood in you?
So I said, yeah, my mum's Italian. So he said, oh, my mum's Italian. I said, oh. So he said to me, what's her name? I said, Maria Josephine Bradici.
And I looked at him and in disbelief, because that is my mother's name. That's the name that's on the birth certificate. That's the name that my mother gave me.
And then
the unfolding of a story that people think could only happen in a soap opera. All those years after giving away her baby, Maria is reunited with Tom. Her other son, Steve, broke the news that Tom had been found safe and well.
Steve, my son, rang and said that he had Tom at his house. I said, Tom who? He said, Tom, your son, my brother. I said, no, I don't believe you, I said. Honest, he says, do you want to speak to him? Yes. So Tom came to the phone and I heard his voice. And of course I said to him, how do you know? He said, well, I've got a certificate and it tells me the date of birth and when I was born. And I said, oh yes, that's right. I thought I was going to, die, you know. I couldn't believe it, that he was at the other end, wandering all those years, and then all of a sudden, there he is on the telephone. It's just unbelievable.
Longest day has just begun. Now my life happens.
It's been quite a year for Tom. Two ambitions realized, finding his mother and being signed up by a recording company. His first single is Write Your Name in Sand.
The theme of it is actually leaving something that you love or somebody that you love for the good of everybody, basically. You know, that the underlying feeling behind the song is, you know, I've got to let you go, but I don't really want to, you know, but it's better for both of us, you know.
Maria never married Tom's father. He returned to Italy. She managed to work and care for Tom until he was 6 months old, but then, unable to cope any longer, Maria gave him up for adoption.
It was indescribable. It was like a stabbing in my stomach. I just... That was it. That was as if everything went black, because it was awful. But I knew I had to do it. I knew that Tom had to be looked after, and I knew there was this lovely family that would take care of him and give him what I couldn't give him.
My adoptive parents have been more than anybody could have been, you know, to bring a child up. Very loving, and they've given me everything, you know, as Maria was pleased to find out.
Oh, yeah.
So my search wasn't because of an inadequacy in my family life. It was because of a curiosity for my origin. I think anybody that's been adopted will be aware of that, need to know your roots. We'll have a toast to future happiness.
Oh, definitely.
Future happiness and success for my... It was a kind of whole host of feelings, you know, because not only was I meeting, you know, my natural mother, I was meeting my friend's mother. It's such a nice family. It was like meeting new friends as well, you know. So it, for me, it's been a success. I should imagine that a lot of people that discover their natural parents or natural mother would be, you know, not as lucky as me.
Do you regard it as a success, Marie?
Oh, I do, yes. Oh, I think it's great. To wander all those years and then that's it, it's there, and you feel at peace. You think you've seen him, and yes, I do. I think it's wonderful.
Have you felt guilty all those years then?
Oh, yes, I did feel guilty. Yes, I did. Yes, I did for giving him away. I did feel guilty. But seeing him and hearing how he's been looked after, then that was all right. That went.
When things work out positively, like meeting Maria and everything, you know, it's unbelievable, but in a way, I don't expect it, but I thought, yeah, you know, how could it have happened any other way? You know, how could my life go any other way? And I feel the same about, you know, getting involved in music.
A little tear in my eye.
Did you?
Know?
Yeah. I could see it.
Brian, yeah. Harry's handkerchief, the white bit, like. So what you been doing? What are you up to?
Well, the song that you heard on the film there, yeah. It's been released as a single.
Yeah, right.
Since, so hopefully that comes out this week.
Mm.
And I remember last week you said you wouldn't, you know, like, do up, do up, and I thought maybe we could exploit that today.
Yeah?
And try you out on this chorus. Right.
Do I have to do up, do up, well, this time, or what? Do I put a little bit of bass on it?
Bass is good, yeah. But feel it, see, yeah, what happens, and
all right,
see how it goes. Well, we'll try
let
it anyway.
Let the rhythm flow, yeah?
Let the rhythm flow.
All right.
Let it roll. Okay, so we go. Write your name inside, oh yeah. Write your name in sand,
ooh, oh yeah.
Write your name in sand,
oh yeah.
Ooh, write your name in sand
and chuck it in the sea.
Yeah, there's something happening,
yeah?
My friend. I've written that. I'm definitely something
you
moving.
You think so, yeah?
What do you reckon?
I'm more of a Jungle Book sort of man, you know what I mean? Shooby doo bop you, I wanna be like you. Ooh, ooh, shooby doo be. I wanna walk like you, talk like you. Oh, shooby doo.
I tell you what,
you see, it's true.
Oh, yeah, the pause.
I want to be like you. You see, the pose is very important,
yeah, I know.
You know what I mean? On my sort of rhythm, you know, it's sort of like different.
The beautiful and ancient city of Oxford, with its trippers, its students, its dreaming spires, and its terrible football team, has also got quite a lot of these dotted around the place. There are about 30 of these stones with strange markings on them. And every Ascension Day, these stones become the focus of a bizarre ritual which dates back to the Middle Ages. And today is Ascension Day. The strange custom involves sticks for the parishioners and choir of St. Michael at the North Gate, and a leader, the Reverend Patrick Irving.
We're going to set off and mark the old parish boundary here through the centre of the town.
How do you mark these boundary stones?
We beat them.
It starts at 10, outside the chemist in the high street. No dawdling.
Those at the back, I would advise to keep up. It's a long way to go. St. Michael at the North Gate, 1989.
And off we go. I'm still not quite clear about what's going on. I know. Ask a local.
It's an ancient thing to mark the boundaries of the parish before maps were come about. And you'll find originally they used to beat the choir boys on the stones.
Choir first, please.
Yeah, so that they would know the boundaries of the parish.
Well, I haven't seen any choir boys being beaten.
No, you haven't. That's what we were told.
There are bike shops and opticians where once the boundary ran through fields and hedges. Most occupants are mildly tolerant, some more than others.
Hey, where did you think you're not going?
We are beating the bounds, my man, yes?
Yeah, well, you're not going on my grass and walking on my flowers, mate. Yeah, you can leave my flowers alone, you can beat that over there on the corner.
As a member of college, I think...
The gardener of Frewin Court is the only parishioner to put up a separate mark of his own, well away from the real one.
The original one's behind the bush, and if they try to hurt the original one, they'll be all over my ruddy flowers. And if they get on my ruddy flowers, I should get annoyed.
Well, as you see, we're by the old city wall, and at this point, you have to descend from here to the area beneath the wall. The hardier members are expected to jump. Chris, would you like to go first?
No, I'm not going to jump.
Well, I think it's sort of wimpish, but if you're really not going to jump, all I can say, depressed as I am, all I can say is you better meet us the other side. Now, let me explain to you how to go. You go through this door here, you turn immediately left and then turn right again, and then you want to go left right round the quad, and then you go left again, and you come out into a little street called New In Horses.
Go for it, Flora!
There's no sign, but it's the first street you'll find. You then turn right down New In Horses Street and come right again. And there you will find yourself in Queen Street, and shortly you will meet the rest of us.
Ah, right. So I'm going the wrong way, aren't I?
I think you are.
All right, thank you very much.
Just there, look.
All right.
Take the bike, but please bring it back.
All right, thank you very much.
With any luck, they'll be here. If they are, it'll be the turn of the vicar, Stephen Picks, to utter the incantation.
And one of the conditions of Marks and Spencers being allowed to build their store was that the old boundary should be preserved. So it's quite an important mark here in the children's clothing department. I'll mark it with the cross first, and then put the initials S for Saint, M for Michael, and then I stand clear.
What did you make of it?
They're beating out the evil spirits.
What about the sticks?
Well, they'd be fishing poles in Louisiana. I'm not sure what they are here.
The bounds well and truly whacked. Lincoln College is where we take lunch. And true to form, tradition strikes again with a strange drink. This is Ivy what?
Ivy Ale.
Ivy
it's
Ale.
Specially brewed by Lincoln College, and it's ale to which ivy has been added.
I could grow to like this, actually.
And there's more. Hot money is the reward for the choir, freshly baked and mixed with cold. Coins will be thrown for the unsuspecting choristers to burn their fingers on. Isn't this fun?
And now, undergraduates of Lincoln College will perform their traditional task on Ascension Day and throw down pennies from heaven.
Anybody found any hot ones yet? Oh, ouch. No, I'm not. I'm collecting it from you. That's now it for the day, isn't it? That's the ceremony over.
I'm afraid it isn't, Chris. No, because we've finished the liturgical part, but we also have a little penalty of our own. For the person we are judged to have been slowest around the course, we have a little present for. So, Chris, you will now receive the reward for being the slowest around the course, which is traditionally a sign with the marking of St. Michael at the North Gate. So, St. Michael at the North Gate, 1989. More!
This is a new production of Robin Hood. It's being rehearsed in a backstreet community hall in the London borough of Southwark. What makes this play particularly unusual is the fact that it's been written, directed, produced, and stage managed by a schoolboy of 12. He's called Ricky, he doesn't go to school anymore, and none of his actors goes to school either. For the last 2 years, in a flat over a sub-post office in Bermondsey, they've been attending their own so-called free school. Here, they can come and go when they like and do almost anything they like. The Bermondsey Lamppost School, as it's called, is run by Lois Acton, a former head of geography in a local comprehensive school.
We try to start somewhere where they're something they can do. And all of them can do something, and all of them have proved that they can really do something very well. And from there, they've gone on to tackle the things that they couldn't do very well.
I can't see how schools of this kind, so accommodated and so staffed, can possibly offer what just a reasonably large secondary school can offer.
It's different. We learn a lot more here because the teacher's got a lot more time for us and they're more interested in what we want to do.
And now, for our amazing highlight, I've made this a whole line. Arrow.
Over the car. Lean.
How does it feel to be so beautiful?
What I do now is I act. I sing and dance and choreograph, direct, write, design, and compose.
I felt like I could trust the teachers, or particularly Lois, really, and I could say to her, I want to put on plays. And there was no, well, you have to do this first, or you know, there was no, yeah, but join the bank so you can have something to fall back on. It was, right, here's a piece of paper, write one, and whatever you want us to do to help you, we'll help you. And they did. You just can't go into a classroom and say, I want to put on a play, because putting on a play takes forever and ever and ever. It's such a lot of hard work, because you don't even think about approaching a teacher in a comprehensive and saying, this is really what I want to do. At least I didn't.
Kim is 15 and one of the latest recruits. She says she never got on with her teachers and was always running away.
I didn't used to go to another school, hardly. I only ever went now and again when I had to, you know. So here I come all the time because I know that I like it and I work hard.
Today, I'm a mother. I've got two children who are now growing up. I live in Greenwich and I have a job at the National Maritime Museum.
What's been the effect of your experience on the lamppost on the way you bring up your own children?
I think I try to treat them as people and understand their needs, and that sometimes they have problems of their own. And hopefully they can come to me and tell me.
Stuart wandered into school at about 11 o'clock this morning. He's one of a family of nine, and he's been coming here on and off for more than a year, ever since he ran away from a comprehensive school. His one passion is cars and how they work.
Didn't know how the gearbox worked, anything, so I came here.
Why is it you think that you're able to learn more about that here than at another school?
The teacher got more time for you here, hasn't he?
I'm a printer. I've just bought a house in Welling in Kent, and me and my wife's just had a baby boy.
Now, when we last met, you were absolutely certain that you were going to be a car mechanic. It didn't work
that's
out.
That's right, like that. No, it never does. But that's a part of life. When we was at the free school, the Bermondsey Lamppost, we was given the chance to develop what we wanted to do, instead of, like, you do it to a system that the state wanted you to do. And your skills, which my skills was drawing, it still is. So I got a chance to develop that.
Now, how much have these children been successful because of the sort of people they are? And how much because of the help that your sort of school was able to give?
Well, I think it's twofold. I mean, they partly came to us because they had the initiative and took it to actually leave their secondary schools. But I think partly because they've met a whole range of adults who've actually been interested and actually care.
So what does it feel like going back into the building now?
It's quite strange, quite strange. What would be nice is if we had all the lamppost children here, and in fact we've been trying to plan a party for years and years and years.
Where was it that we found it? It was just around the corner, wasn't it?
Yes, just around the corner. Ricky, I didn't know you were all going to be here. As usual, my goodness.
I've got an excuse now.
God, Ricky. God, it's amazing. What a big surprise.
Look at the glory of that colour. Isn't that marvellous?
Yeah.
I think it's a wonder. There's such a simplicity about a single egg, and yet it means so much. The symbolism is absolutely incredible.
This is an egg?
Yes, an egg. An egg.
Oh, wow!
Mind you,
really cooking, man.
You can see, did you see?
It bubbly. Is still alive. That is some egg.
Gosh. That's it.
So what do you want to do with this egg?
I want to show it. I want to exhibit it. I want people to see what a wonderful thing an egg is.
And how are you going to show it?
When someone offers me a line, preferably over a river, over the River Thames. When you want to show something, you hang it up. There it is. It's wonderful. This is a kipper, for instance. It's lovely, the colour and the shine, the deep reds and the oranges.
And hasn't it been taken up by anybody yet?
Not yet. But, you see, I have shown these socks in Leicester, in the Leicester Abbey Park Festival last year.
Yeah.
And we hoisted them in a gale, and they danced and swung about in the gale. It was fantastic, and they were just like ordinary socks on a day like this, when everything's blowing around.
Yeah.
And nothing is static. It was really fantastic. I want pensioners to have more money so that they'll be able to buy more food to warm them from the inside and not have woolly hats. I'd like to make them 20 foot by 10 foot and put them in Threadneedle Street. They represent a dream of the homeless, and you notice all the doors are open. So that's a sort of a welcome, isn't it? If we hung them over the festival hall, and when they woke up in the morning, they would see all these houses and they'd think, are they really for us?
Do you ever feel that the world's not quite ready for you yet?
Of course. Yes, we feel that. I think everyone that has any sort of vision at all, they want really to get hold of people and shake them. Can't you see it? You see, that's suppose our attitude. But we do it in love. We don't do it in anger. We do it in love.
Okay, are you ready on the floor? Take Bob away.
Here in Studio 8 at BBC Television Centre, six acts are rehearsing for Bob Says Opportunity Knocks. Each one hopes that a four-minute spot in front of 11 million television viewers will make their name. 10,000 acts audition for the series, and less than 70 win a place on the screen.
Will you be there?
For Angie McKay, this is the chance of a lifetime. Will at last opportunity knock for her?
Here we go. And cue orchestra.
At home in Pembrey, South Wales, Angie and her family have spent weeks building up to the big day.
As the trees reach blossom.
Keep that feeling.
Angie's a single parent. She and five-year-old daughter Jessica live with her parents, Ken and Val. The family's confident that she'll win Opportunity Knocks and start a great career.
I'm thrown in too much. Mm. I feel like I'm...
Mm. Yeah, that's
and when
it.
You get that's to the I'm not the smiling enough. No. I'll have to, and of course, I'll have a camera on me. I'll have to keep looking in the lights.
Yes.
I know that I have a talent. I have a good, strong voice. And I'm going to realise my dream, and my name is eventually going to be up there in lights.
Angie's been a hotel receptionist and cook, but now sings professionally. Many entertainers spend their lives performing in clubs without so much as a twinkle of the bright lights.
It's pretty hard graft to win the clubs, I can tell you. Got paid off my very first night, and I ended up with £15 going home. And I swore I'd never get paid off again.
And why are you paid off?
I was a paid off because they thought I wasn't good enough.
Were you?
Of course I was. And that night I swore that I'd never get paid off again in my life. This is your apprenticeship, and I've worked this apprenticeship for 7 years now. So it's about time something else came about.
It's a full house. All eyes are down and staring intently at bingo cards. Angie is on after the next game.
Who's playing for you tonight?
Just an organist and a drummer. They have already been through my music with me 5 minutes ago. I've never played with them before, and it's just luck whether or not they're capable of playing my music in my key.
With your hand resting in my...
When I see Angie singing, I feel very, very proud, very emotional. But I try to keep a low profile because I know that's what Angie likes. I don't go overboard.
You're going out for opportunity knocks and you've got to be spot on.
The family has been studying videos of Angie's club gigs so that her opportunity knocks performance will be perfect in every respect.
I've got to keep my hands more static.
Mm.
And you've got to be
a good girl
and sit on the tram.
You could be with me on history, Dad. Yeah. Huh? It's a different time, eh? You're right in the very back of
week. Are you going to cheer for Mummy? And then we can come back here and watch it on the television. Is it? When it's all over.
Part of the price of becoming a star would be long separations from Jessica. And that would mean more responsibility for Angie's mum and dad.
They want success for me. So they're always there to look after the little one when I have to travel. And if the future, it will involve a lot of travelling, they'll always be there to look after her. So I've got no worries. I can just go ahead and do it and strive for what I'm aiming for to get there.
What do you think? Is she going to win opportunity knocks?
Yes. In a nutshell, yes. She's got it.
This is my one big shot at it, and I'm going to make the most of it and try my best for my friends and my family.
Next week, we'll be with Angie on the big day. Her first appearance on national television and perhaps the start of a bright new future.
That's all for tonight, but if you've got a good story, you can write to me at the Beeb.
Hello,
Harry. All right, nice to see you.
Your show last week.
Yeah.
Well done, mate.
Thank you very much, Harry. I hear that you're going to eat some frog legs and get us, you know what I mean? Go over to France and
you should
Harry.
Know of all people not to believe everything you read in the paper.
I believe everything I read in the Sunday Sport.
Hold on a minute. I need my usual prop when I talk to you. Now that's better. Right then, what were you saying? I'm going to France.
Yeah, you're going to France. You're not leaving us, Harry. Why?
Not just yet.
Yeah?
I'm going eventually, for a little more time.
Yeah.
Not just yet. I've got some work to do. You don't think you're going to get rid of me that easily,
boy,
do you?
That's very good, Harry. That's very nice. You know?
Now listen, how's
I've
it
got
going?
A bit jumpy.
How's it going as a television presenter?
Well, I think it's much more harder than boxing, Harry, because I've got to say more than you know what I mean, Harry. You know, my brain's getting sort of like different exercise, but I'm giving it a try, ducking and diving.
Can I give you a little tip?
Put it in this hand, Harry.
When you talk to the camera, treat it exactly as if it's a person you're talking
to. Right. Yeah?
Shall I show you what I mean?
Yeah, Harry. I know what you mean. I think I do.
Well, that's it from people tonight. If you've got a good story, write to him at the Beeb.
You're getting a bit too good.
Know what I mean?
See you next week. Cheers.
People like you. Millions of lives, ships in the night.
up, Evolution! France prepares for its 200th birthday party, and Radio Times looks behind the scenes. Vive la romance! Win the dream weekend for two in Paris. The Radio Times shows you how. Vive la différence! Chantal Cuer.
Ma journée favorite.
Vive la Radio Times.
Le seul guide hebdomadaire aux émissions de la BBC Télévision et Radio.
On BBC Two shortly, Jonathan Dimbleby explores the British government's policy towards freedom of information in the State of Democracy with Sir Frank Cooper, Andrew Neil and Des Wilson. Here on One, that politically minded pensioner is beset by the question, is there anybody there, as friends and relatives link hands in sickness and in health?